Computer. Here we are. So good afternoon, everyone here, everyone who's joining online. My name is James Milner. I have the real privilege of being the project director for LEARN, the Local Engagement Refugee Research Network. We're a seven-year partnership with partners here in Canada, partners in Lebanon, Jordan, Kenya, and Tanzania. It's a collaboration between researchers and practitioners and refugee-led initiatives with a focus of understanding and enhancing the role of civil society in the functioning of the refugee regime. One of the real priorities for LEARN since we began in 2018 is the question of refugee participation. We're very privileged to have on our advisory committee our two speakers who are here with us today, Muznad Druid and Mustafa Alio, who I'll introduce to you in a moment. We understand refugee participation not only to be important in the discussion of needs and opportunities, but really in all stages of the research process, in the identifying of research questions, in the development of research agendas, and in the undertaking of research, in the analysis of research findings, and in the mobilization of that knowledge to affect change. We were very excited in the last few months to be involved in a process that led to the Government of Canada, including in its delegation to the Global Refugee Forum, a meeting in Geneva in December 2019, including in the delegation for the very first time, a refugee representative. The Global Refugee Forum brought together some 3,000 participants from member states, UN agencies, NGOs. 2% of those representatives were refugees. And if it was a UN meeting on women's rights or indigenous rights, and 2% of the population was of the participants were women or from an indigenous background, it would be seen as a problematic process. But one of the bright moments from the Global Refugee Forum was the moment when Minister Mendicino, Canada's Minister of Immigration, in Canada's statement to the plenary, said how important it was to the Government of Canada to include a refugee representative, Mustafa Alio, as an advisor to the Canadian delegation, and critically that moment said, Mustafa, welcome to your seat at the table. You could look at that and say that it was a gimmick. You could look at it and say that it was tokenization, that it was symbolic. You can also look at it and say, was this a step along a much longer journey of ensuring refugee participation in global policy discussions in the decision-making of the regime created after World War II to ensure protection for refugees and to find a solution to their plight. So what we have today is an opportunity with two very important refugee leaders in Canada and globally, with Muznad Druid, who is the liaison officer for the White Helmets, the government liaison officer for the White Helmets here in Canada, along with many other advocacy campaigns. Herself, having arrived in Canada as a refugee, has been a strong and tireless voice for not only refugee rights in Canada and globally, but women's rights as well, and also the connection between conversations with refugee issues and issues of Indigenous rights here in Canada and abroad. So Muznad will be speaking to us in a moment in her experience of having been a refugee representative as part of a refugee delegation in November in Geneva for one of the preparatory meetings. And this is an example of what impact do refugee voices have when they participate in global processes, not as part of member states, but as a delegation in and of their own right. We'll then have a chance to hear from Mustafa Alio, one of the co-founders and managing directors of Jumpstart Refugee Talent here in Canada, a really exciting organization that's involved in encouraging new pathways for individuals with a refugee background, not only to come to Canada, but to be able to contribute into the Canadian economy and the economies of Canadian communities. But Mustafa has also been a very passionate and tireless advocate for refugee participation in global networks. I had the real privilege of meeting both Muznad and Mustafa for the first time in May 2018, when Osama Salim, who was one of the founding members of the Network for Refugee Voices, was at Carleton University for the Canadian Association of Refugee and Forced Migration Studies. It was Osama's presentation that I heard in Germany in November 2017 that really animated for me, or really crystallized for me, the challenge of refugee participation, but also how the simplicity of refugee participation. And he made the point that at the Rio Olympics, we had a refugee team participating under the International Olympic Committee flag. And if the International Olympic Committee can change the rules of membership for a refugee delegation to compete in the Olympics, how hard could it possibly be for the decision-making body of the UN refugee regime, UNHCR's executive committee, how hard could it possibly be for there to be a refugee delegation participating in that meeting? But what we have are two very interesting potential models. One model of refugees being part of national delegations of UN member states, so that the presence of refugees being integrated into the perspective of UN member states, and given the nature of multilateralism, where states hold ultimate decision-making within these fora, is the refugee perspective most powerful within a delegation versus the symbolic value of refugees participating as refugees in a particular delegation, or both? So what we've proposed for this conversation with individuals here at Carleton University, and those of you joining either now online or in future online and watching a recording of this conversation, is first to be able to say, what is the experience of participating in a refugee delegation in that experience versus the experience of being a member of a member state delegation? What are the pros and cons of these models? And if we think about where progress can be made on refugee participation in the decision-making of the global refugee regime in the months and years to come, what's the evidence? What are the opportunities? How do we address issues around accountability, legitimacy, representation? But where, through research, through policy, through advocacy, where can progress best be made? So what I propose that we do is start with an initial conversation about the experience that we've had, tease out some of these questions about the lessons that we learn and contrasting those experiences, and then open it up for discussion in terms of what we take away from this contrast and where we see opportunities going forward. So with that, Muzna, I'd open the floor to you. Your experience, as I understand, is being supported by the Government of Canada to be part of the GRN delegation. The GRN is the Global Refugee-Led Network that both of you were involved in June 2018 in the summit in Geneva to bring together more than 70 refugee-led organizations and refugee-led initiatives and networks from around the world. So with this one group that it is going through a process of formalizing itself, we should say, as claiming to be representative of the diverse perspective of refugees around the world, being part of a delegation of five or six in presenting the perspective of refugees in the preparation for the Global Refugee Forum. Can you give us a sense of what you were able to do in that context, what you felt you were able to achieve, what you felt you weren't able to achieve, and the pros and cons of being part of a refugee-specific delegation? Muzna, over to you.
So first, it's this opportunity, it could be not happened without a state to fund this initiative. So the first questions, it came if there's like a funding to bring refugees from different countries to attend, to travel to Geneva and to participate in the meeting under the umbrella of GRN. What I do, it's I participate in bilateral meetings of GRN with the URCR, with Turkey, with Sweden, and also in writing the statements of GRN in the first plenary in the first day. So it was like a good experience because it's like it's more general for like to have a voice for all refugees all over the world and to give them like the role of to monitoring the meeting, the work, and the commitment of the states, and also to urge the states to do like more commitments, and also to observing also the situation and like asking for more, but still there's like a limit power for the refugee delegation, as it's there is no like in terms of legitimacy, how it's if it's like legitimate or not, how the those like recommendations that we wrote it's taken as serious as it should be, and also like the how the participation of refugees gonna be in the next like meetings if there is no funding, for example, from Canada or like from another state, so how the sustainability of that participation will be. So this is like the major questions, because like if not it's gonna stop, so there is no sustainable work, which is it's not for me. We're gonna have no zero outputs after like three or four meetings. But this is still like for me, I see like the refugee delegation so it's so important for refugees who based in neighboring countries or like the first countries they fled to, like Turkey, Lebanon, like all countries who like anti-refugee with the anti-refugee policy or like approach, because they don't have like any chance or opportunity to speak about and write their voice about the issues that they facing over there. So it's just like to having the collective voice to protect refugees and to protect activists and advocates more than to be like with the delegations. So even though like let's imagine Lebanon or Turkey or Jordan or like whatever like those countries who hosting the refugees, if they have a refugee with their delegation, how their participation looks like, it's going to be limited and like it's just like to repeat and to the same approach and the same policy that those countries do. But when we have like independent delegation, they could speak and they could like raise all concerns and to tackle the problems that of the refugees in all over the world. Mm-hmm. So yeah, this is what I see. But like for sure, as I came as a refugee from Canada, so I prefer that like the outputs like to be with the delegation, it's more than to be with the refugee delegation. So I see like refugee delegation, it's super good for, let's say, global south countries, like a refugee who is still in global south, and a government delegation as like for global north or like for resettlement countries.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you very much. And it's interesting with that intervention that as much as we, you know, as a political scientist, I get caught up in questions of sort of governance mechanisms and decision making, that there are very core questions of funding. And, yeah. You know, one of the core challenges that's been identified in terms of refugee participation in these global discussions, the cost to physically get to the meeting and the access to a visa to allow you to enter the territory of the country where the meeting is taking place. So I think it's very important to, as we balance off questions about structures and, you know, governance structures and processes, that we don't lose sight of the real practicalities. And that while there's a commitment to refugee participation now, and that means that countries like Canada contribute funding, yeah. That doesn't mean that 5 years from now that will necessarily be there. So we could have the best mechanisms in the world, but in the absence of the money to pay for the travel,
exactly,
that participation is going to be moot. So it, and as Musna presented, you know, the value of a refugee delegation as a refugee delegation presenting that perspective, we had the contrast with that really exciting moment in December. Well, really the exciting moment, I guess, in late November, when the government of Canada agreed to have a new seat, a new space on a Canadian delegation at a global meeting on refugees, and for there to be a refugee advisor to the delegation, and a lot of work that was needed to build trust and confidence to, because there was no protocol, there was no precedent. But given all of the work that it took to achieve that, and some of the constraints that were then placed on you, Mustafa, as a member of the delegation and keeping confidence of what was happening in the conversations of the delegation itself, on balance, what was the experience of being the first refugee advisor to a Canadian delegation? What was that like? And what do you feel, if you weigh up the, you know, the costs and the opportunities of being on a refugee delegation where you're free to speak versus a member of a national delegation where there are constraints on what you can be saying publicly, on balance, where do you see the value and the impact? How do you assess the significance of a government like Canada having as a member of their delegation a refugee advisor?
Okay. Thank you so much for being here and for you guys to come. I think it's also important, as you mentioned, James, to start in the point where that did not happen out of the blue. It just, I think, building trust required a lot of meetings and conversation, being on so many different tables with the government to advise on different issues. And I think it's really a good model. The reason why I mention it, it's a good model even for refugees in other countries, that to be active, to involve in those kind of discussions as much as possible, at the same time to be laser focused on a certain target. And I think participating in so many of those conversations, and definitely with the support and learn, had a lot to do with this early on in Ottawa or different places, was always kind of, you know, the advocacy, the topic that we need to have a refugee on the delegation. And that somehow brought some of trust to some of the officials in the governments, and I think that was the first great milestone that we passed. And then once that trust established, and we go on. And for, I mean, somehow it's a more of a process that has a different layers and different levels. And every time we kind of pass one, we get to a little bit harder one where more details need to be provided. So it was definitely exciting and great to be invited on the delegation. At the same time, all of a sudden you feel that there is something that you've been advocating for like years, and now it happens. Then what right. What's next? You feel that, okay, that was the goal. We get the goal right now. So what we have to do with it. So aside from the excitement, I think I was a little bit nervous in that way, and I felt there was a lot of pressure and responsibility putting on me, because again, there was the thoughts of I don't want to be tokenized. There was a thought that am I going to be able to actually say whatever I wanted to say, to advocate on the right things? There was a thought that it's a first time for a refugee, as a refugee, not as a representative of a certain organization, basically to be on a delegation, and a lot of pressure in a way that maybe this will set the tone for other countries or states, or maybe future for other refugees to be on this. It's one of those rare situations where someone would say, the ultimate success when someone take my place, it's not the ultimate success when I stay in my place, in that sense. So definitely that's from a point where it required a lot of preparations and talk, but I think there was a lot of value in it. And if I want to break the value, not only for me, but I think maybe if I want to bring it in different stages. A, it was a simple act that has a lot of, like, has a tremendous effect, not only on the look of Canada as a state, the perception of it. It was a simple act that affected other states, other refugees globally in a way where they felt empowered to actually take it as an example and then go and advocate with other states. And maybe the perfect example you just mentioned, James, when Osama, like, basically mentioned that if an Olympic that were able to do it, like, to create a refugee team, then how hard is it for others or UNHCR and all of that to start this kind of conversation? And it was one act that led to another, which is the creation of refugee-led networks, the creation of that kind of voice, and then the need that refugees should participate. And definitely what happened in Canada, I always feel it's also one of the results. It's part of this global conversation that happened in that sense. And I think right now the ball is rolling. It's on to us where to have it. So definitely it was an act that is a win-win. It's a win for the government and state to show that they are inclusive, they are welcoming, and they are serious when it comes to refugee policy. It's also an act that empowered other refugees without actually putting any cent in funding of refugee empowerment or participation, by, I guess, just basically leading by example. Mm-hmm. Also, it was an act where I felt a few of the members in the delegation got a little bit more empowered. I felt like some of them gained a little bit more authority on saying what they want to say, just the fact that they have a refugee. And what I mean by this, like, one of the examples, a member of a delegation, they were in a separate meeting I wasn't in, because I was with them in a preparatory meeting to the whole GRF. And I did mention there's always that kind of a very political correctness and where people cannot say things that they have to say or maybe they want to say. And one of the small examples I was saying is, like, I advocate a lot on showcasing the refugee economic contributions and actually to put them in a way as an economic power, not as an economic burden in that sense. And I was saying, I'm a refugee, it's okay to talk about me as an opportunity because that's where you can make the conversation.
But I give you permission.
Exactly. And then it was a member of a delegation and a high profile member at that point. She came to me and she said, I used your sentence in one of her meetings saying it's okay to talk about refugees as an opportunity. And somehow for her, that she couldn't feel comfortable enough saying this, that she wanted to say it to present an idea without having someone on that delegation. She felt, you know, we have, like, it's not my say, it's their say. Mm-hmm. And hopefully that directed also the conversation. Even the minister had a chance to sit with him and then to have a chat about what we think, what are some of the perspective on the ground. So hopefully that participation also empowered and informed the delegation itself as a government when they do their bilats or even what they do present their advocacy. But also, it was also very empowering for me to know the kind of conversation that happened on the other sides, to know what kind of, you know, conversation, because if I know, then my advocacy on when I'm out of that would be better informed, would be more effective. Mm-hmm. I know what to ask for, I know what can be done, and I know what cannot be done in that sense. So hopefully this, when I go and then chat with the other refugee leaders internationally, if we're asking for something that I know it's not going to happen because based on the conversation I heard or how the conversation happened between, for example, states and others. So hopefully in that way, we are in a better place to organize and to find those kind of a middle ground. Mm-hmm. So it's not kind of, you know, each one of us or each party operating in a complete silo where refugees don't know exactly what to ask, what to advocate for, at what stage and all of that. And then there is a whole organization or community that also operate in a complete silo than refugees, right? I'm not saying that at the end they will agree on everything, but then also that kind of participation hopefully will let everyone know where the middle ground is, and hopefully we can collaborate eventually on doing something. So those where I felt, and definitely the last one, being on a delegation, it's also good because it doesn't limit my conversation, my participation only to one area, to one topic, to one thing. I'm being able to participate in the general conversation, and that was For me, it was really good. It was something different because all my previous participations were like kind of one topic, one point. I got to go to it. Like that's, it's kind of like, you know, planned. Your way is planned there, but in here, I had a lot more freedom in saying and raising the points I want to raise. Mm.
And it's, there's an interesting conversation between the two. I mean, Muzna, in your experience, that there was a sense that there were bilateral conversations that the Global Refugee-Led Network was able to have, but the kinds of bilateral conversations that a civil society group is able to have relative to a member state like Canada, that substantively they're fairly different. And so one argument would be, you know, there's the formal agenda of a meeting in a multilateral context, but where the real business happens is in the bilateral meetings, is on the margins, is in the informal. And so what I hear from you both is it's not so much the substantive difference of refugee impact on the formal agenda, but it's more where influence can be had. So the kind of the productive power that you can have in influencing the way concepts are understood and the way options are understood. So within a delegation, that you're able to influence the way that delegation behaves within the multilateral system. Is that a more powerful point of entry for refugee participation than a standalone delegation? Or are they different kinds of entry points? In other words, should we be giving a preference to one or the other, or is there an argument to be made that we should be advocating for both?
We should advocate for both.
Why?
But keep in mind the logistics and to keep the participation in terms of financial things. So this is just like that. The concern for that, but like in general, yeah, we should, because like not all refugees they been resettled in countries that respect and advocate for refugee participation. So we should keep this space, free space for those refugees who've been in very tough like countries to raise their voice and to speak. And also like to advocate for so many like the same questions for refugees from different level and from different stage. So,
and Mustafa, from your point of view, we've talked about this a bit, but is it a question of both, and that there are different roles that these two mechanisms of participation can play?
I mean, eventually, I think right now it's. I don't think the question should be right now, it's either or. Mm. I think we can definitely work on both of them. And any of those happening in a way, hopefully will strengthen the case for the other thing to happen, because eventually they will be very complementary. Mm. They will be more powerful together. I mean, and maybe just kind of to bring it in a context of, I think the refugee and the state delegation is more like the translator for the work with this kind of a refugee delegation in a way. Both of them, let's say, speak a little bit of a different language. Both of them operate on different schemes. So one of them more on the ground, a very passionate, very kind of coming from a humanitarian lens, from very need lens and all of that. And that's a refugee delegation. And definitely there is a huge need for it. And actually, I feel it's more of a must that happen, especially it opens space for refugees in some hosting countries or other countries where it's not even a thought to have that type of refugee on a delegation. So it opens that space. But at the same time, with states, they're speaking their own language. So hopefully having a refugee on a delegation becomes the bridge that connects the refugee delegation with the state delegation by having this. And I think the conversation would be a lot smoother, would be more effective, would be even results would be faster in that way. Mm-hmm. Where we understand that a refugee on a state delegation will have some constraints like any member on a delegation in terms of like, you know, what to say, and they have to be very calculative in terms of their acts, their moves, and all of that. Maybe they're a little bit more freedom on a refugee delegation, but then having that bridge will be will be very important, mm-hmm. will be very effective, and I think will make both works even more powerful.
Okay. Let me ask three more questions. The three more questions I want to ask of the two of you, and then I'm going to open it up to others for thoughts. And then with the time remaining, we'll bring it back to question of next steps and sort of where we go strategically on some of these questions. Mustafa, we've talked about this. You know, this is not the first time that Canada has had a refugee on their delegation. And Canada's former Minister of Immigration, Ahmed Hussein, himself came to Canada as a refugee. But there's a distinction between an individual participating, representing an institutional place in a delegation, who happens to have a refugee background, versus someone participating as a refugee. Right? So I want to talk about that distinction, because the role that you mentioned about being a bridge builder, being a translator, being able to, you know, the Minister Hussein used to tell the story about how, you know, he got the Minister of Interior from Hungary to fall off his chair when the Minister from Hungary was saying all of this, you know, stereotypes about refugees, and then it passes to Canada and the Canadian minister is able to say, well, I was a refugee. And so that refugee identity, that legitimacy, that credibility that comes from having a displacement experience in your background, you know, is there something distinct about that perspective being brought as an individual speaking to that experience, as opposed to someone wearing an institutional or a bureaucratic hat? So in a Canadian delegation, there will be different government departments and agencies that are represented. There will be different sectors of Canadian civil society that are represented, different sort of constituencies that are represented. Individuals playing those institutional roles have been refugees in the past, but this is the first time that there was someone as a refugee participating as a refugee. Is that just cosmetic? What difference does that make? I mean, some could say that it was a real, you know, Canada didn't bring any substantive new money to the Global Refugee Forum. This was just a fancy trick in saying that. So how would you answer those who say, you know, we've had refugees on the delegation before, they've just played different institutional roles? And how would you say, you know, that this is a bit of, you know, this was easy for Canada to do, and maybe it distracts us from some of the bigger things that Canada could have done at the Global Refugee Forum? So how would you answer the question of, you know, well, is it such a big deal that it's a refugee participating as a refugee, as opposed to being a member of a delegation in a different format, one? And how do you answer the question of, well, this was a cosmetic thing to do, not a substantive thing to do?
It's how to ensure the sustainable work. So if Canada like had a government that has a minister from refugee background, that doesn't mean that it's going to continue for all governments that are going to come in the future. Mm. So how are we going to ensure also in another meetings that the refugee voice is going to be present in all meetings? So this is first. Second, it's like all diplomats should meet and should like follow the policy of their governments, and like using terms in like follow the diplomacy in general, without talking about the how like the advocate speak about the issues or the concerns. So there's like a difference between them. So
the performance of the advocate versus the performance of the diplomat.
Yeah. So both of them, it's a strong. But yeah, we should like keep like the balance of both, especially that the government it's changing, and like ministers also changing. So it like one times with Minister Ahmed Hussein doesn't mean that it's gonna be like forever.
That's gonna be forever.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I think the argument, like if it's interesting. I had the same conversation with a friend about a few months ago, where to say that we were talking about, like, how does it look like to have a real partnership with refugees? And the idea is, like, you know, we have employees who are refugees. We consult with refugees and all of that. And I was saying, having an employee as a refugee or consulting with them, but at the same time make a decision that you want to make, or basically they cannot actually make a decision because their whole decision-making process would be affected by the risk of not being in the organization, hence will be directed by the policy of the organization itself, the interest of the organization itself, not the interest of this person as a refugee. In that sense, the other thing I want to say, so if I think if we take it in that way, that a refugee, like basically someone who's a former refugee but coming in the name of organization, and this is a meaningful participation, then I mean the whole work that we've been doing right now for years on refugee meaningful participation basically should not been happen in the first place, because many of the UNHCR itself senior officers were refugees at one point.
Right.
So the whole complaint about UNHCR saying that, you know, that they don't consult with refugees, they can just come back, is like, no, we have a refugee certainly there. And I think this is really the breaking point. Yes, it's a big deal when we say that someone is coming as a refugee, not representing an umbrella or an organization, because at the end, this person will be mandated and restricted, that there will be like two layers at that point. There will be the layer of the organization this person coming under, and then there will be the layer of the formality part of the delegation. There will be like so many layers in that sense. And I think that's why having a refugee as a refugee is a complete different norm and different things, and that's what was the breaking point of this. Than that. Even actually in one of my panels in the GRF, I did say it's a different multiple layers and different levels. I mean, one of the reasons that happened, for example, having refugee as a refugee on a delegation in Canada did not start just the advocacy and all of that, but also it's a collective work. It started by Canadian government having a former refugee as a minister. It started by people elect refugee on that. But then at the end, this is a great, but having refugee as a refugee on a delegation is a complete different thing. Like, that's why, I mean, there has to be a clear line between those two things, because otherwise, again, like, I'll just bring it back. UNHCR, even we can make an argument that it is a refugee-led organization.
So then that raises, you know, the perennial challenge of, within a domestic context, when we ask questions about, you know, the legitimacy or the accountability or the representativeness of our elected officials, well, there's an electoral process. There's a process by which they're selected. They may not represent, you know, they may not have been selected by all members of a constituency, but then they come to represent everyone within, you know, so the representative governments. When we get to the global governance, when we get to the UN system, there's a whole other layer in terms of representativeness and accountability and legitimacy. To what extent does the Syrian representative speaking on behalf of Syria speak on behalf of all Syrians? So those issues are always there. But these are the yes but questions that are always asked about refugee participation. Right. So the Global Compact on Refugees, there's more than 70 mentions of refugee participation. So it's no longer a question of if refugees should participate, but the question of how. And then the question becomes, you know, who counts as a refugee? Right. So is it someone who has a displacement experience within the last 5, 10, 15 years? Someone who had a displacement experience 35 years ago, can they still legitimately claim to speak to that experience? To what extent does the individual who plays that role as representing refugees as refugees on a delegation, is there do they need to in some way be accountable to refugees in the political community that they're representing in some way? So we have these perennial questions about legitimacy. How do we deal with the questions of legitimacy that someone can claim to be speaking to the refugee experience? And so within your thinking of who can legitimately claim to play that role, and then is it important that they are representative of refugees in Canada, and to what extent do they need to be accountable to those refugees? Or Or are these just academic questions that in reality we can use as excuses to get hung up on, as opposed to delving into the real work of moving forward with the principle of participation without getting caught up in the definition? Mm-hmm. So from your point of view, what would you, if someone said to you, you know, someone who, Senator Ratna Omavar, fantastic advocate for refugees, will tell her story of having arrived in Canada through a displacement experience. But, you know, how would you speak to someone saying, well, she had that as part of her experience, but now she speaks from a position of privilege, right? So who can legitimately claim to speak as a refugee? And second, is it important that that individual be in some way selected by, representative of, or accountable to other refugees? So who can legitimately call themselves a refugee in that space?
Yeah.
And how, or do we need to worry about these questions of representation and accountability?
I think you started the intro to this when you said that 2% in the GRF, imagine if that was a women conference or an Indigenous conference. Imagine that question being asked to a woman. Like if there is like something about women, and someone go to that woman and say, like, how are you representing all women? Mm-hmm. I don't think anyone, women, Indigenous or refugees, should claim that they represent the whole population. Or mm-hmm. I always try my best to emphasize on the fact that I don't represent all refugees. Mm-hmm. I represent myself as a refugee, my experience as a refugee in that way, my experience of working on the ground in that sense. So it's really at that point, what I want from people is that to focus on the message, not on the messenger. Mm-hmm. And that way, now we see all of those kind of questions as a representation. It's somehow, to be honest, I feel like when some people talk about this, it's just a ridiculous questions, because as if someone asks, like, you know, I'm the only time I'm going to count for refugee, like for someone to talk on behalf of refugee as a legitimate, if someone represent all refugees, the 72 million right now refugee in the world, including IDPs, and that will never happen. So that's going to be catch 22.
Right.
And then, you know, like, that's it. So I think, what the focus should be on, how can we create a better representation through focusing on the message, what need to be delivered, what people are saying. Until then, again, we try to do our best. At the same time, it's on us who get lucky or privileged to be present on those stages. Mm-hmm. Also to, which is the refugee themselves, to also take the initiative to try to hear to other people's perspective, refugees, try to ask to consult, to work on the ground. So it's not kind of, at the same time, it's not okay for someone just for the fact that they are refugee, like, okay, just because a refugee, then you're bare. So it's not a box check. Mm-hmm. It also comes with, there has to be a work on the ground, there has to be experience in that sense, there has to be years and all of that. So all what I'm trying to say is trying to give the refugee the equal footing. I'm not saying it's like you should just listen to anyone just because they are a refugee, mm-hmm. but it's good also to look at their background, the history, the work, the experience, mm-hmm. what they do. So it's kind of, you know...
So it's the refugee, it's the displacement experience plus... the way that what action has derived from
exactly
that?
And then the work on the ground. So what I'm trying to say, it's a kind of a mutual responsibility on the refugee representative to do the work and do their homeworks and the experience on the ground, but at the same time on the other, not kind of just to hang up and focus always on the messenger, not the message.
Mm-hmm. For me, I see that like each one has a different story, different barriers and different obstacles. So yeah, it's like stories and like experiences, it's important. And there's like a proverb that like equality, it's having a justice system. Diversity is having a voice. Mm-hmm. Inclusion is having a seat. Mm-hmm. So each one should have the seat mm-hmm. to speak to about like the like his or her like own stories. But like even though it's like if we see like the municipal like consultation with the residents, so they trying to hear from each resident and each citizen what their own opinion about like having like a tower in the street or something. So
whether or not to put up a stop sign, you're gonna have it, right.
Yeah. So we should like keep those consultations between individuals, between institutions, and as much as we can, like keep the participants diverse from different backgrounds. It's not to keep the same people who like represent this like in the same meetings. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we're gonna have like much better outputs. But yeah, it's like it's valid like to try the question. It's like for me, I prefer like to having people who like who've been displaced in last 10 years at least. Mm-hmm. It's just like because like the situation it's changing from day to today. Mm-hmm. The walls is like rise, like they building walls like each year there's like a new law, new obstacles. So yeah, it should be like people who like be aware about all what's happening in the world
and remain engaged in those issues.
Yeah. So it's like just like keep in mind the diversity of all participation in all meetings, not in one. Mm-hmm.
So in a moment, I want to turn to questions about sort of, you know, the what next and how to make sure that it's sustainable and what kind of initiatives can be undertaken to address questions of capacity and identifying who those representatives might be. But I want to open it up because a number of people around the table work on these issues in different contexts in East Africa, in the Middle East. Some work on these in similar issues in the context of Brazil. Some work on these in more conceptual ways in terms of what participation means. So I want to open it up if there are questions that come from other contexts or if there are questions of clarification, if there are ideas on these questions of legitimacy or accountability and how, you know, there's always the risk that we talk about, you know, refugee participation in Canada, including a refugee on the delegation. But we were saying before, you know, that there are other governments that it could actually be quite problematic if Syria arrived and said, we have a returnee on our delegation. Yeah. And this individual is going to say about how, what a great job we're doing as a government to prepare for repatriation, that tokenization can be very difficult. So it's important not to assume that every political context is going to be similar to the one that we address here in Canada. So I want to open it up for questions or for comments for others around the table that might want to jump in. So I'm pleased to bring in Dr. Ola El-Tayawi, who's our new postdoctoral fellow in global refugee policy. Welcome, Ola.
Hi, thank you very much. So I'd like first to thank you for this, for sharing your marvelous experience. Just this talk in this room brings up a lot of thoughts in my mind, a lot of questions. I know there won't be enough time, but I was thinking on this issue of representation that, and I'd like to hear your own thoughts about this because you're the ones who have had this experience, is that while we may not necessarily need to think about it in terms of individuals, we'll never have 72 million people on the table. But what about if we think about it in terms of categories? And I realize that this has its limitations, definitely, because individuals have different stories, have different barriers. But if we think about it in terms of categories of representation, because would that help? Because like you've pointed out, a refugee who has been legally named as a refugee and has that legal status in a country of resettlement deals with different issues than a de facto refugee, but who doesn't have the refugee legal status in another country and deals with other issues, or an internally displaced person with, of course, the logistical issues and the political issues that would involve getting that person on board. But with thinking about representation in terms of categories be at least a compromise of sorts.
Yeah, actually by categories it's like much easier because like I have a similar example that for CSW meeting in New York. So Minister Maryam Mounsef, since she been appointed, it's like Minister of Women Status. Since she been appointed, she brings women rights advocates to CSW.
The Committee for the Status of Women, which is the follow up reporting mechanism within the UN system on the CIDAW.
Yeah. So she selects like the advocates from like under the category of their experience of women rights. So which is like easier. But when it comes like to be selected as a refugee, so like for me, it's like I'm represent both categories. So it's going to be like much difficult to be like to represent, like to participate as a refugee. So yeah, it's like recognized participation by categories. It's much easier. And for logistics, it's also because like there's like problems of visas and travels for sure for women for a single woman it's single mom it's difficult than like a single advocate. So yeah, it's there's like a lot of
but can I maybe take that idea just sort of one step further. I really like this idea. It may be categories, maybe constituencies, right? So for example, the representative on Colombia's delegation, the biggest phenomenon of displacement in Colombia is internal displacement. So maybe that person would be an IDP. So maybe we get that diversity of profile by having national constituencies. I mean, Vela, does that kind of sort of take the idea of categories? Or?
Yeah, because what I'm thinking, because I think about, I'm a policy scientist, so I think in terms of, for any government, to them, they translate things into the practical sides of hosting refugees. Mm-hmm. So when I think in terms of categories and the barriers or the issues that every category deals with, that's I'm thinking like a government representative, for instance, or government official things. So, for instance, a refugee needs access to some kind of financial assistance or economic opportunities. What will be their legal status and for how long? And so these are the things that I'm thinking about. And that's why these things change from different categories or constituencies, one from the other. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm thinking, maybe we need to think about it in terms of representation of categories rather than.
And especially sort of with permanent status, where the integration process is different as opposed to someone with a limited legal status. I mean, this was sort of a conversation we're having today about, you know, an individual arriving in Canada as an asylum seeker with a temporary status as opposed to permanent residency. You could almost then say if we use the categories approach, then there are different categories even in selecting who a representative would be from the Canadian context. Does that?
Yeah, I mean, with the category, absolutely right, because definitely makes it easier. I think we mentioned, if I understand it correctly, we did mention it even more when I say the category is very important, but also the experience in the background is important too. So it's kind of like a two layers of representation. That's what I'm saying. So for example, and by the way, this is an approach that maybe many of you don't know, but even between Muzna and I, when we get invited, and she gets invited way more than me to some events or international way. But what good, and this is something really what good about Muzna is
not that anyone's keeping track.
Yeah. If when she gets invited to something that she knows this is not her category and this is not her area of expertise, she doesn't go. She always just tried like connect with me. She talked to others, and then we always kind of perform in a way that can we send someone else. Who is a representative of this category and also someone who had an experience in this. Otherwise, which is also sometimes, and we fall into that trap of tokenizations and kind of like, you know, one person, one face for everything to talk about refugees, IDPs, economic, women's rights, and all of that. It's like, it's just as if, you know, the superhuman, which doesn't exist. So yes, I think, definitely representation should come with this, and that's why I was saying that it's a both responsibility as those who wanted to involve refugees and invite them with their governments and all of that, and also responsibility of the refugee themselves when they get invited, that we understand our limitation, our expertise, background, and what are we representing exactly. I would never go, for example, talk into a conference or a refugee, or like basically go specifically for a refugee woman rights. That's not my space, nor that's my expertise in that sense. So yes, definitely that makes it easier. And when that happened, like as we're working on it, actually in every single conversation, even in a few initiatives that we're trying to work on, hopefully to address the representation issue, we definitely always integrate the fact that people, even talking to government, we've always say that, you know, it's not only a refugee for the sake that they're a refugee, they also need to have the right category and the right experience.
Amanda.
Yeah, thank you for this. It's very interesting. So I'm just curious, I guess my question is kind of twofold. So one, you had mentioned about refugees in the Global North participating more in terms of the actual country delegation, and then refugees from the Global South participating more in the the refugee delegation. But I'm wondering how, again, that access for participants from the Global South who are perhaps still in precarious situations, how that could be something that they get involved with. So that's one question. And then the other is, I know that there are many countries who perhaps have not formally recognized refugees, but are starting to maybe participate in these conversations a little bit more, or, you know, have affirmed the Global Compact, and how you might see countries like these bringing refugees in as representatives when they're not formally recognized still.
Yeah, but like for example, our meeting with Turkey as a refugee delegation, it was like super good, because also when they asking me and I answer, so they recognize me as a refugee who came from Canada, not as a Syrian. So this is the question. It's like, how, what's your value in our world, or like in those meetings, right. And even like the Turkey representative, she came to the our panel and at the evening, and she talked to Wang, and she said like she's like a good representative to Canada. It's like, so she repeated as I came as a Canadian participant, not as a Syrian or like as a refugee. So this is why there's like a different, whether we accept it or not, this is the real. So and the only way it's like that the civil society do in that system, it's to monitoring the states and the countries. So this is their job, but they couldn't like to be under government's umbrella and represent governments. So this is why their role, like a refugee delegation, is so important to keep to keep continue, especially like to keep in mind for long term. There's like also a lot of mobility difficulties for refugees to go and to participate. So to guarantee that there's like a space and seats for refugees is so important. And in the same situation to with the government delegation. So both of them, it's really important.
I think the answer to your question was like, that's what we talked about in the beginning. So like what we're talking, there are two kinds of delegation we want to try to advocate for. So one kind of it was just like for with countries like Canada that to have a refugee on the government delegation. But there is another kind, which is a full refugee delegation. So it's not kind of part of any country. It's on its own as of like a team, as a delegation. And that would focus on those countries, refugees, who we know, and refugees, they did not even sign the Geneva Convention, or they did not recognize them as a refugee. So basically that refugee delegation would be a good space for refugees from those regions and those countries to be part of. And that's how, hopefully maybe it's an answer for how can we get those people involved, like refugees in those countries to be involved through that kind of a refugee delegation.
Right, but I think my question was actually just more about access for refugees in those contexts to be involved in. Like I understand the difference between the two, but
and this, I mean, it sort of goes back to the question, you know, we mentioned, you know,
the ability to well, the selection, but also the position, you know, how the trust has been built up over the years and how, you know, that you've developed this access, you know, in other contexts, the how to avoid, you know, the perspective, going back to categories, the perspective of the young, connected, privileged, articulate, literate refugee in a particular country who is able to advocate, that their perspectives and needs and priorities may be different from those who don't have access, who aren't literate, who don't speak English.
Yeah.
You know, the barriers to participation can be financial, they can be legal, they can be social, they can be economic. That, you know, that there are lots of different ways. So I think it's really, is there a vision that we can construct? You know, I use the analogy of the illiterate grandfather refugee in Chad who doesn't have access to email or, you know, to advocate electronically and to be part of social media based networks. So how do we ensure that, you know, the category of the young, articulate, mobile, connected, tech savvy, you know, you've been mobilizing in a powerful way.
Yeah.
But are there other perspectives? Are there other, you know, categories of identity that are not represented in that conversation?
Yeah, that reminds me, like last year when Nadia Murad awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, and a lot of questions, a lot of people like asked, like, why Nadia? Is because like she was raped and as a Yazidi refugee, or for what? So, but not, it's like Nadia awarded the prize, it's because she works for women rights, and she raised the question of like, what's the situation of Yazidi women refugees in camps and everything. So it's the same for representation. Representation doesn't come from like, okay, just like because you are a refugee, you can't come and like participate and that and speak. But it's comes from like accumulating experience, work, and also be involved in so many initiatives for the cause. Mm-hmm. I know like sometimes there's a lot of refugees who it's difficult for them to travel to not like having the luxury to be like far away from their family or like having the capacity to do that. But this is this like it's not like the system, but this is what like there's requirements should be like for those people who gonna like set before the states and set before like high. Like high level meetings that they to deal with it. Mm. I remember like first meeting I attended in Bosnia with them for Syria. I cried because this is the first meeting I attended. It's like, why people like having, why we have like a cocktail like at the end of the day? It's like people like dying in Syria and here we celebrating.
Our canapes,
like,
yeah.
So for people who like, who doesn't like who haven't like the same experience or like who like this first time for them to attend that, it's gonna be tough like to deal with that. So this is why experience is important. And I know like always there's like the first step and the first experience should be, but it's not at that level because like all the time states like they wait for any mistake from refugees, especially now when there's like a far right wave. In the world. So this is why we should be aware and like for all terms and like how we're dealing with that issues.
I'll add one more thing. I'm trying to answer like the access, how would they access it?
Yeah, so, well, and even having that voice, right? Because yes, obviously you need to have some kind of level of privilege and experience to be able to go and participate. Yeah. But I think ensuring that those who are not fortunate to have been able to participate in and gain this experience and be able to necessarily be educated or whatever, how those perspectives are translating as well.
So outside of the, or beside that we need a little bit more outside of the box ideas. Mm-hmm. I mean, James and I are trying to work on one to make sure that the representations and the voices of those who are on the ground, basically they have access to participate in this process. Currently right now, I think it's definitely, it's a multi-layer process. I think one of them by advocating more for empowering refugee-led organizations, local organizations in those regions. And I think when we try to advocate for this, then hopefully we're giving access to those people to come a little bit and to have that direct connections with donors and others from the Global North. I think the rise of the conversation and the popularity of, you know, having a refugee representations internationally, hopefully will encourage those on the ground to have a little bit of hope and then to kind of, you know, and to proactively try to access that space. I think the other way is that, which is the most important, is that for us who are here, or people who are, as you said, in a privileged place, because definitely I am in a privileged place, even though as a refugee and then all of that, to also not forget about those and proactively try to figure out a way and proactively try to reach out and see if we can have a more representation. And to be honest, like, I think I want to bring this to a point that's at least personally what made me believe the most and learn and then made me excited that I wanted to be part of this project, because it's one of those projects where proactively saying, I want to go on the ground, we connect with you, connect us with refugee-led organizations who are not picked by UNHCR, who are not picked by NGOs, who are actually picked by refugee themselves in that sense. So it's, I think as of now, it's a more really a multi-layer, it's more a proactive approach. And definitely refugees and non-refugees in the Global North has a tremendous responsibility of being proactive to ensure and reach out to those on the ground and hopefully either to get them to be involved if possible and then to bring them and then to those. But if we can't do this, at least to consult with them, to have a chat with them, to understand what's going on the ground and hopefully to try represent their ideas in the best way possible.
And I think this sort of transitions us with the 5 minutes or so that we have left to talk about these practical steps. And Mustafa, I do want to flag sort of that point, you know, in contexts like Lebanon and Jordan or like Kenya and Tanzania, you know, there are refugee-led initiatives that get highlighted, that get showcased, and there are others that get silenced. Yeah. And so it's really interesting to have this conversation. Like one of the Kenya working, Learns Kenya working group includes a refugee-led initiative that hasn't been recognized as part of the structure of refugee consultation in the Kakuma refugee camp, but yet has a legitimate perspective in terms of the issues of refugee participation. So this question of which actors, which gatekeepers have the power in contexts like Lebanon and Jordan, Kenya and Tanzania, to be able to say, these are the refugee-led initiatives, these are the refugees that we're going to bring into the conversation. Because going back to the question of what does that mean, having a seat at the table, well, if you're able to say there's someone has a seat at the table, and either I know that they're not going to speak against what I represent as an organization, is that full participation? But so, Mustafa, you alluded to some of the ideas that we have and at the policy dialogue that LEARN co-hosted with the Refugee Hub in September. There were a number of discussions about ways to enhance refugee participation. One of them was to launch a refugee mentorship program where we were able to support a number of refugee leaders in the Canadian context who would apply, be selected, be matched with a mentor. But also, you know, going back to this question about the language and the performance of participating in these global meetings, to make sure that when an individual is selected to be on a delegation, that they have the training and the knowledge so that when they have their seat at the table, that they're able to participate as equals. And so there are these questions now about how to select individuals, how to promote this, with whom to partner, to identify who these potential leaders might be, and once selected, how to build that capacity so that there are many refugee leaders in Canada who could legitimately step in to that role of being on a Canadian delegation to refugee to a UNHCR executive committee meeting. I mean, what are the kinds of ideas that we can generate in terms of how to diversify those individuals who could play that kind of role? Mustafa.
So definitely, and that's what actually we need the help of all of you and then others in that sense, like just to bring more ideas on how can we institutionalize the refugee participation with governments in that sense. And I think the first idea we thought, which is to create a refugee advisory committee to the Global Affairs or Government of Canada, and then definitely that refugee advisory committee would have a term in that sense, and then to combine that committee with the mentorship. And that's the mentorship. I mean, the mentorship idea is not new. I mean, it's like I'm afraid that even when people is like, oh, this is not nothing new. So, but what unique, what we found, one of the gaps about refugee participation. Again, I think Muzna and I and people like you know us in a way were lucky that we got to the stage that we get there. But then there is a gap. I always feel it. There is always a ceiling. I feel for the refugee leaders or refugee representation where we cannot go above and beyond and outside of that ceiling. So hopefully this and this is around diplomacy training, around being more effective in those participation, around what to do, and this is why we're trying to create kind of a two mechanism at once. So one mechanism, which is to create a proper body that is selected by people who are trusted in that sense and serve only for limited term, not kind of forever, 2 years term, but at the same time to combine this body with mentors that would improve their skills on diplomacy, on work effectiveness and all of that. And hopefully, basically, the participation of having a refugee delegate on every act or conference or trip that Canada as a government does for refugees, to have a refugee delegate, not necessarily to be part of those. I always say it's like, it might be part of this kind of advisory committee, but it could be even the advisory committee would say, you know what, there is a refugee that we know on the ground that would be a better fit for this participation. So we have it. This is one idea, and I think this is where we now I think we are at a great stage with the government. It's not about, like kind of always James said, it's not about the if right now. I mean, everyone understand that, yes, it's not the question of the if should we have a refugee on delegate or not. Now they understand, they acknowledge all of this. So now how can we make it? I think now it's kind of somehow on us to propose a proper mechanism and propose proper way. And definitely that's where we need help, definitely we can work on. But any idea that comes from any of you or even outside, whether now or in the future, please let us know.
Yeah, having selection committee also, it's important, mixed from refugees and NGOs, workers, could help. And having open access for people to apply and to being selected, it's not only by nomination, but also anyone, any refugee could apply to attend those meetings or to be representative. I think it's important also.
Mm-hmm. Are there any final points that anyone would like to raise before we close? We're just about at time. So please go ahead.
I think it's a very great and awesome conversation happening around. When we talk about the different, whether it's with government delegation or whether with as a refugee delegation, I think also one of the things which need to be emphasized on is to look at the effectiveness on both aspects, right? So for example, if the focus is only to create the solid delegation, and then that solid refugee delegation is created, and then, it's not listened to or nobody cares, just refugees from around the world, they're going to see a new city or a new town, right? But then we look at on the other side of if they're with the government, then, how can they help transform the system from within, right? Mm-hmm. So we looking at the cost and the benefits on both ends and say, which one is best to first push at first? And then when you get to a certain stage and then see if now you can bring another initiative instead of since this opportunity of government are slowly starting to listen in terms of including refugee voices in some platform or some voices, and to see how can that maybe groomed or how can that be entrenched in the system and then making change in the system also, and then see how can now the creation of just a refugee delegation.
I mean, that's one of the great challenges of a multi-stakeholder process and a policy process is how you identify and delineate what impact did the role of one particular actor have in the outcome, and then how you then measure who gets to define what constitutes success. So our definition of what might constitute success or impact of refugee participation might be very different from what another set of actors might identify as being impact. But I think the point of that participation is not just being present. I think participation is having the capacity and the opportunity to actually influence the outcome. And I think having that as our, that's as good a place as any to make sure that that's ultimately what we need to be focused on. It's not just the performance and it's not just the presence, but it's, you know, what's the empirical basis of being able to argue that increased participation by refugees in the multilateral global policymaking process results in what we might call better policy. You know, one of the arguments that's been made, and a really good policy scholar might be able to take that on as a project, but you know, one of the arguments has been made is that refugee participation is not just the right thing to do, but it's a good thing to do. It's the right thing to do because it's morally desirable for those who are the subjects or the objects of a policy to be involved in the making of that policy. But it's also a good thing to do because does refugee participation result in more effective policy, more legitimate policy, policy that refugees themselves will recognize as being legitimate, and therefore there's a greater likelihood that they'll comply with that policy? I mean, are these the kinds of markers that we can think of? One of the greatest takeaways of not just 2015, but of events before that, is that when refugees view policy regimes as being illegitimate, they have the agency and the capacity to be able to move. You know, Somali refugees in Dadaab have resisted the encampment policy of the Dadaab structures by choosing to take on the perilous journey of leaving Dadaab, and they've been doing it for 20 years. So does effective policy mean that it's seen as more legitimate and therefore accepted? Muslim Mustafa, I want to give you the final word if that's where, you know, what's the ultimate goal of participation? What does success look like for the two of you?
You know, Matt, you brought a great point where I feel all of this right now happening with a good intention that, yes, there has to be an outcome, right? And this is Mustafa talking, so not kind of anything else. I feel the huge part of the tokenization that happened with refugees is actually the outsiders, where they're stay silent and not hold the refugee accountable in that sense. I feel we need to do, like, it again, as you said, so we're struggling or even trying to advocate for that participation to happen, but also people who are from the outside need to hold us accountable toward the work that we're doing, toward the impact that we're achieving. And maybe that's where I feel sometimes academia could play a great role in this, with all those centers for refugee studies that exist in different countries and all of that. Definitely it should create maybe a measurement or a research, or maybe have some focus around the impact of refugee who participated in that sense, and hold us really accountable with our presence and participation. Not kind of to feel uncomfortable. Again, this is only me, my own preference. I prefer someone who come criticize my presence and criticize constructively my representation or the work that I'm doing, and hopefully help me to do a better impact, that just someone basically just kept silent just because of the fact I'm a refugee, and then feels like, oh, like, who am I to talk to them in that sense? So yes, it is a great concern, and definitely a great matter on my mind, and then everyone's else mind, that beside the advocacy for more representation, meaningful participation, all that. And meaningful participation doesn't only mean ability to make a decision, but also means the ability to make an impact, right? In that sense. And then the impact can only be measured and happen by outsiders, not by refugees. Nobody can judge. I cannot just go and say, I made a great impact. That was my work. I'm not going to make a judgment on my work, right? But I would rather others from the outside to tell me, to judge me on this, right? In a constructive, in a proper way. So there is, again, that's what I said. It's a both and responsibility. Mm. It's a responsibility of the international community, the outside of the NGOs, the non-refugee, to hold those refugees who are participating and doing the advocacy accountable to the work that they're doing.
Muslim, last word to you.
I'm not optimistic at all.
Oh, come on.
It's like while all those meetings happening, it's just like to collecting money and like to having like competition between hosting countries about like who is spending more money than others on refugees. And sometimes it's symbolic more than anything. For me, like success, it's like to having to changing policies and laws. This is what's mean for me and what's like affect people's lives more than anything. At the end of the day, you need like to having policies and laws who protect yourself and your family and your children and everything more than okay having like refugee in delegations, like, you know. So yeah, this is for me. So as long as we have a new laws and new policies that welcoming refugees and changing and improve their lives, this is what should be like as a results of that work that we do.
Yeah, and I think there's a really important reminder that refugee presence on delegations is not an end unto itself; it's a means to an end.
Yeah.
And I would like to really thank you, Muzna, and you, Mustafa, not only for the openness with which you share the reflections today, but also the really pivotal role that you've both been playing in LEARN. You talk about, you know, outsiders holding refugee leaders to account, the way that you have both held LEARN to account to ensure that we actually deliver on that commitment of including refugees in all aspects of the work that we do. So we'll hold each other to account as we hope to be able to realize this change that I think, Muzna, that you so powerfully presented to us as a challenge. So as we sign off, can I just ask everyone to please join me in thanking Muzna and Mustafa.